York, this is Democracy Now!
They put us under a bridge where we slept, and then we were taken to a jail in Texas. I spent 5 days in jail. Look what they gave us as a blanket to sleep on.
The U.S. is deporting hundreds of Haitian asylum seekers from a makeshift camp of 15,000 people under a bridge in Texas, despite protests from Haiti, which is facing a mounting humanitarian and political crisis following a devastating earthquake and the assassination of its president. We'll go to Del Rio, Texas, for the latest. Then we speak to an abortion provider in Texas over the state's near total ban on abortions. Over the weekend, one Texas doctor revealed he'd provided an abortion in open defiance of the law. Then we look at the deadly consequences of vaccine inequality.
More than 5.7 billion doses have been administered globally. But only 2% of those have been administered in Africa. This leaves people at high risk of disease and death, exposed to a deadly virus against which many other people around the world enjoy protection.
We go to India, where groups are calling on Johnson & Johnson to stop exporting Indian-made vaccines to wealthy nations, including the United States, at a time when hundreds of millions of people remain unvaccinated in India as well as in Africa. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The Pentagon acknowledged Friday the U.S. drone strike that killed 10 civilians, including 7 children, in Afghanistan in the final days of the U.S. withdrawal was a tragic mistake. The Pentagon previously asserted the strike prevented an imminent threat by ISIS-K fighters, but investigations quickly revealed the victims were instead aid worker Zumari Ahmadi and his family members. His family's demanding a probe into the killing. This is his brother, Ramal Ahmadi.
They should accept and pay their damages. They should come to me and apologize and offer their condolences. They should pay blood money. We are innocent. They should evacuate us.
In Washington, D.C., lawmakers said they would investigate the deadly strike, while activists renewed calls for an end to U.S. drone warfare. In other news from Afghanistan, most secondary classes resumed without female students, as their fate remains unclear under the new Taliban leadership, who only explicitly ordered male students to return to the classroom. Some boys refused to attend class until all students were allowed to return. Meanwhile, the new Taliban mayor of Kabul told female municipal workers not to come to work. On Sunday, women activists rallied in front of the building which used to house the Ministry of Women's Affairs in Kabul, an agency the Taliban has done away with.
You cannot suppress the voice of Afghan women by keeping girls at home and restricting them, as well as by not allowing them to go to school. You cannot suppress the voice of Afghanistan's women by turning the Ministry of Women into a ministry of the promotion of virtue and prevention of vice. You cannot suppress Afghanistan's women.
Meanwhile, Al Jazeera reports at least 7 people were killed after a series of blasts in Kabul and the eastern city of Jalalabad Saturday. ISIS-K claimed responsibility for the attacks. The Biden administration sent 3 deportation flights to Haiti Sunday as part of its efforts to speed up the mass expulsion of over 14,000 Haitian asylum seekers who've been staying in a makeshift camp under a bridge in Del Rio, Texas, for days. The flights each carried at least 145 asylum seekers. More flights are expected to depart in the coming days. Haitian officials have urged the U.S. to stop the deportations, warning they don't have the resources to assist the incoming asylum seekers as Haiti is still reeling from last month's catastrophic earthquake. Immigrant justice advocates blasted the Biden administration for launching what could be one of the most abrupt and largest mass deportations of asylum seekers or migrants in decades. This is a Haitian asylum seeker in Del Rio.
I don't want to be deported. If I'm deported now, I'll die in Haiti. Why? Because there's no security in Haiti. They are bandits. There's a civil war every day. Civil war with the police, with bandits, police civil war. Very complicated because there's no leadership in Haiti. There's nothing.
Rights groups are also denouncing the U.S. government's ongoing attempts to block Haitian asylum seekers from applying for refuge, which is a violation of international law. We'll go to Del Rio, Texas, after headlines. In another blow for immigrant rights, the Senate parliamentarian ruled Sunday Democrats cannot create a pathway to citizenship for millions of people as part of their $3.5 trillion spending bill. Democrats were hoping to pass the measure, which could grant citizenship to immigrants with temporary protected status, or TPS, essential workers, farm workers, and those brought to the U.S. as children, by passing the package through reconciliation without Republican support. Democrats say they'll keep fighting for comprehensive immigration reform. Advisors to the Food and Drug Administration recommended booster shots of the Pfizer COVID-19 vaccine for people 65 and older and those who are at high risk of developing severe infections. The recommendation is far more limited than President Biden's previously announced plan to offer boosters to anyone who'd already received two shots. Meanwhile, Pfizer announced their COVID vaccine is safe for children age 5 to 11 and generates a strong immune response. Pfizer hopes to receive emergency use authorization soon. In California, fire crews are battling a large wildfire in the Sierra Nevada mountains that's threatening Sequoia National Park, home to the world's most massive trees. Over the weekend, firefighters wrapped protective aluminum foil blankets around old-growth sequoias, including one nicknamed General Sherman, the world's largest tree by volume. The KNP complex fire has grown to over 21,000 acres and is just 3% contained. The United Nations warns the planet's on course for a catastrophic global temperature rise of 2.7 degrees Celsius, even if nearly 200 UN member states meet their stated goals for cutting emissions. That's far beyond the 1.5-degree goal of the Paris Climate Accord and would mean a massive loss of lives and livelihoods, with whole ecosystems collapsing amidst deadly heat waves, powerful storms, and rising sea levels. On Friday, President Biden unveiled a plan by the U.S. and Europe to cut global methane emissions by 30% by the end of the decade.
For our part in America, I'm working to pass historic investment and to modernize our climate-resilient infrastructure, to build a clean energy future that creates millions of jobs and ushers in new industries of the future. As part of this work, the United States is committed to reduce greenhouse gas emissions between 50 and 52% below 2005 levels by the year 2030.
But it's unclear if Biden's pledges will be possible given the ongoing obstruction of Democrats' infrastructure and climate plans by Republicans and conservative Democrats like Joe Manchin, chair of the Energy Panel and the largest Senate recipient of campaign donations from the oil, coal and gas industries. Dozens of climate activists were arrested in New York City Friday as they staged peaceful actions demanding big banks stop investing in the fossil fuel industry. Activists held protests in front of the headquarters of J.P. Morgan Chase, Citibank and Bank of America. The actions come as world leaders gather for the U.N. General Assembly and ahead of November's U.N. Climate Summit in Scotland. This is Presley Hayashida of Extinction Rebellion.
I would love to see people who are actually talking about the climate crisis realistically and not making, you know, 20-year plans, 30-year plans. We can't talk about 2050 or 2030 anymore. We have to immediately stop fossil fuel investment.
France has recalled its ambassadors to the United States and Australia after the Biden administration said it would provide nuclear-powered submarine technology to Australia, subverting a French-Australian deal. It's the first time since the U.S. and France became allies in 1778 that Paris has ordered its top diplomat back to France for consultations. The White House is reportedly pushing to have President Biden call French President Emmanuel Macron in the coming days to soothe strained ties. The diplomatic row followed last week's announcement that Australia, the United Kingdom, and the U.S. are forming a new military alliance known as AUKUS. Just ahead of the announcement, Australia canceled a $65 billion deal to purchase French-built diesel-electric submarines. In Russia, preliminary results show President Vladimir Putin's ruling party on track to retain its majority in the lower house of parliament after an election that saw near-record low turnout of just 45%. Opposition groups blasted the results, alleging large-scale vote rigging. Ahead of the election, police arrested thousands of activists, including supporters of the jailed opposition leader Alexei Navalny. In Canada, voters are casting ballots today in a parliamentary election that Prime Minister Justin Trudeau is hoping will deliver a clear mandate to his Liberal Party. But the Liberals have been in a tight race with the Conservative Party, with the progressive New Democratic Party polling in third place. The leaders of the two main challenging parties accused Trudeau of calling the snap election amidst a Delta-fueled fourth wave of COVID infections. In Algeria, former President Abdelaziz Bouteflika died Friday at the age of 84. His burial Sunday was a muted affair, even though he held power longer than any other Algerian president. Mass protests led to Bouteflika's resignation in 2019 and resumed earlier this year, demanding an end to Algeria's entrenched political elite and military rulers. In Tunisia, protesters took to the streets in the first major demonstration since President Kais Saied ousted the prime minister and suspended parliament in July, assuming executive authority. Protesters are demanding democratic rule in Tunisia, which was the birthplace of the Arab Spring a decade ago.
We followed a revolutionary path for 10 years in which there were negatives and positives, but what happened on July 25th took us back 50 years to autocracy.
Back in the United States, in Washington, D.C., police in riot gear surrounded the U.S. Capitol grounds Saturday, outnumbering an estimated 200 protesters who rallied in support of the pro-Trump mob that attacked Congress on January 6th. The so-called Justice for J6 rally failed to draw the large crowds organizers had hoped for. Ahead of the event, crews reinstalled a high metal fence around the Capitol. In labor news, Nabisco workers in five states have ended a weeks-long strike after union members overwhelmingly approved a new contract that includes a 60-cent-an-hour annual wage increase for the next 4 years, a $5,000 bonus for all employees, and blocks proposed cuts to workers' health care. Nabisco workers say they've been forced to work grueling 12- to 16-hour shifts during the pandemic, often including on weekends. And in New York, Governor Kathy Hochul signed the Less is More Act Friday, which ends jail time for most nonviolent parole violations, including technical violations and marijuana use. Hochul said nearly 200 people will be released from city jails under the new policy, which comes amidst mounting outrage over the crisis at Rikers. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman in New York, joined by Democracy Now! Co-host Juan Gonzalez in New Brunswick, New Jersey. Hi, Juan.
Hi, Amy, and welcome to all of our listeners and viewers across the country and around the world.
Well, we begin today's show in Texas at the Del Rio border crossing with Mexico, where thousands of Haitian migrants have set up a makeshift camp under the Del Rio International Bridge, including families with children who hope to seek asylum in the United States. Del Rio is about halfway between El Paso in the west and the Rio Grande Valley to the southeast, and a three-hour drive from Laredo. At one point Saturday, there were reportedly more than 15,000 asylum seekers under the bridge. This is a 38-year-old Haitian migrant named Richardson, describing the need to bring food and other supplies from the Mexican side of the border back to the camp.
We are having a hard time. Our family sends us money, but we can't eat. We have children, but don't have nappies. Look, now I have to cross to the Mexican side with wet money to be able to buy things for the child, and we have nothing. We are unable to eat. I need help with everything that's happening to us over there on the U.S. side, because there are a lot of children, and they are only removing the single parents, and the children are left alone. Just imagine.
The
children and pregnant women are the only ones left with possibilities, and they are separating the pregnant women on one side, but the children are being left on the floor. Just imagine. I have to go and buy food for the children.
This comes as the U.S. Department of Homeland Security has vowed to accelerate deportations to Haiti. On Sunday alone, the U.S. sent three deportation flights to Haiti, each carrying at least 145 asylum seekers, and several more are expected in the coming days. Last week, the Biden administration appealed a court order to stop using the COVID-19 pandemic as justification for expelling asylum-seeking families. This is U.S. Border Patrol Chief Raul Ortiz speaking Sunday in Del Rio after hundreds of agents shut down the border crossing.
Our expectation is to have up to 3,000 migrants transferred out from underneath the bridge to our processing facilities or to a flight line within the next 24 hours.
Immigrant justice advocates are blasting what could be one of the largest mass deportations of asylum seekers in decades. Rights groups are also denouncing the U.S. government's ongoing attempts to block Haitian asylum seekers from applying for refugee status, which is a violation of international law. This is a Haitian asylum seeker in Del Rio.
I don't want to be deported. If I'm deported now, I'll die in Haiti. Why? Because there's no security in Haiti. They are bandits. There's a civil war every day. Civil war with the police, with bandits, police civil war. Very complicated because there's no leadership in Haiti. There's nothing.
Haiti is still recovering from a devastating earthquake in August and a presidential assassination in July. We begin with Jacqueline Charles, the Haiti and Caribbean correspondent at the Miami Herald. Welcome back to Democracy Now! You're in Del Rio right now, usually covering what's happening just on the island, but you are right here because so many thousands of Haitian asylum seekers are in Del Rio. Can you talk about what you've learned? What is the journey they are taking? And how are they being dealt with in Del Rio? I mean, the head of Border Patrol, Raul Ortiz, is actually from that area, the Del Rio area.
Well, one of the problems is that the media, we are not being given any access whatsoever to this encampment. As you mentioned, the bridge has been closed. Even on the Mexico side, I went to Ciudad Acuña a few days ago. You cannot access this bridge. So we don't know what is happening. What I've been told by some advocates that are here is that the way the process works is that when they move over, when they move through the Rio Grande, for instance, there's an area where they have not yet presented themselves to Border Patrol. And then once they present to Border Patrol, they have this number that they're given. So, for instance, yesterday I spoke to a migrant who was there for 6 days, and his number was 2,200 and something. And that's when you hear they talk about being detained or being jailed or not being able to get access to food. These are reports that we're hearing, and there's mixed reports. Some migrants said that they did have access to food. Others say they don't. I saw migrants on the Mexican side leaving in order to go get food and to bring food back into camp. And even when we went on the Mexican side, I went to a dam, which is a crossing in the Rio Grande. I actually walked through the Rio Grande and walked over to the U.S. side, but we were not allowed to advance, even though we were journalists. So this is a huge issue, the lack of transparency around this, not just in terms of the processing and how they're deciding, you know, maybe who they may let in or versus who they're sending. But what we've been told, and I've been told by the Haitian government, is that they have been told to brace themselves. They are to receive at least 14,000, you know, and that's a huge number. And so yesterday there were three flights, and you're going to start to see three flights a day, maybe even more. There were children, there were families that showed back up yesterday. So this is difficult. And when you talk to these migrants, unfortunately, there are a lot of rumors that are motivating them. So the journey begins in Chile, or you could say that the journey began in Haiti after 2010. You have a large number of Haitians who ended up in Chile, Brazil. I did a story a few years ago. I traveled to Chile. In 1 year, that country received 1% of Haiti's population. 100,000 Haitians migrated to Chile in a year. But life is very difficult for these Haitians there. They would like to remain in these countries, but they can't. It's very difficult. So they take this journey. It's sometimes, for some, it's a couple of weeks. For some, it's a couple of months, 4 months, through the Darien Gap, which is the jungles of South America. It's very dangerous. Some people don't even survive it. They spend thousands of dollars, and we're talking about $4,000, $5,000, $7,000. They sell whatever they have, and they end up in Mexico. What they're telling us is that life in Mexico is even more difficult than it was in Chile or Brazil. There is no jobs. It's a hard time to even find housing. So there's in one area, a state in Mexico, where it's been completely shut off to these migrants. And so rumors have started to fly that, hey, Del Rio was open. That border is open. Tijuana was closed. Laredo's closed. But Del Rio's open. So people started flocking to Ciudad Acuña, because in this community of Haitians, everything moves by word of mouth and it moves by WhatsApp. I've heard rumors. People think the cartels are involved. I've talked to migrants. Everybody tells me the same story. It's word of mouth. The person who goes before you, they tell you what to do, how to pass, what to do. So now all of a sudden we've got 15,000 people under this bridge, most of them Haitian. And now word is starting to spread that Haitians are being deported. So when I went to this dam, what was interesting is there were a number of Haitians who were there and they were contemplating their fate, contemplating their next move. Should they cross or should they stay? There was one gentleman, Alex, his wife and his child were both inside. He came out in order to get food. When he came out to the Mexico side, that's when he started to hear that the United States was starting to deport people. So when I met him, he was sitting on the dam, on the concrete part on a slope, and he was contemplating. He actually was deciding that he probably will not go back in. I said, you're going to allow your wife and your child to go ahead of you without you? He says, listen, if I go back to Haiti, they're going to kill me. You know, so my wife and my child, they have a better chance if they're deported back to Haiti than for me. So this is the tragedy in all of this, that you have families that are divided, people that are trying to figure out what to do, and they are desperate because they've gone through all of these countries, 11 countries through South and Central America to reach what they're thinking is El Dorado, only to find out, no, the border is not open. There is no TPS. You have been misled by misinformation. And even when they arrive in Haiti, I'm hearing people say that the government signed deportation papers. No, you weren't even allowed to present your asylum claim to the United States, so there are no deportation papers. And as far as the U.S. is concerned, you broke U.S. law because you entered illegally. You know, so there's definitely, I think, on both sides, the Haitian and the U.S., there has to be some sort of an education campaign so people truly understand this process and what it is that they've done.
Well, Jacqueline Charles, I wanted to ask you, first of all, about the role of some of these South American governments. Chile, for example, Chile is not a densely populated country. And how did the government deal with the migrants over the last decade or so, the Haitian migrants when they arrived there? And also, what's been the role of the Mexican government dealing with the migrants who obviously had to pass a long distance through Mexico from the south to the north to get to the border?
So let's first start with Brazil. After 2010, there were a number of thousands of Haitians who were fleeing through Brazil, and they were dying in the Amazon. And what the Brazilian government did is they started to provide humanitarian visas to Haitians who were coming so that this could stop happening. They were very proactive. And at the same time, Brazil was preparing for the World Cup, and they were also preparing for the Olympics, and they needed the labor. So we saw a lot of Haitians. I don't remember the number, but it was hundreds of thousands of Haitians who went to Brazil. And life was good in Brazil. You're Black. It's a predominantly a Black country. They may not have known Portuguese, but, you know, they were struggling, but they were surviving and they were able to send money back home. Then the economy in Brazil turned. We had the whole corruption scandal. And so Haitians said, you know what, let's go to Chile. We can go to Chile. We can work. We can get money. But then when they went to Chile, Chile is not a country that's very receptive to Black, you know, immigrants, Blacks are less than 1% of the population, if that. So Haitians had a hard time, from the weather to the fact that they were staying in these apartments that were the size of closets. They were working 16-hour days, 6 days a week. I mean, when I went to Chile and visited and talked to them, I was there for over a week. It was a very difficult existence. And so they were looking for their next move. And so now we started to see, you know, Haitians started to move out. They were going by foot. They were going by bus. Maybe depending on where they are, they had to fly to it. But this was basically mostly a foot journey that they were doing. And people were dying in the Darien Gap. And what you started to see in countries in South and Central America, they started to close their borders. Even Venezuela, you know, before Haiti changes allegiance from Venezuela to the United States, you know, Venezuela was a very friendly country to Haiti, right? They were shutting their borders. They were not allowing Haitians to cross through. We've seen Panama, thousands of Haitians who have been stuck in Panama and even Costa Rica. And we're continuing to see this. And then they ended up in Mexico. And so we're talking around 2016 when you ended up in Mexico. And at this point, we did not have deportations to the United States. When they got to Mexico, all of a sudden you get to a place like Tijuana, doesn't have any blacks. And all of a sudden you have all of these Haitian migrants all over the place. Central Americans are having a hard time trying to access. And then what happens? The Obama administration shuts down the border and they resume deportations to Haiti after 6 years of having no deportations because of the 2010 deadly earthquake. So people were now deciding, okay, should I try to risk it or should I stay? They basically decided to stay, most of them, and they started developing a community. The Mexican government responded by also creating some sort of a residency program for Haitians to allow them to remain in Mexico legally. But over the years, that has been rolled back. And so what you have today is that you have Haitians in Mexico, either who have been here since 2016 or people who are newly arriving from these South American countries, and they cannot get work permits. They cannot get jobs. It is a very difficult situation. Their families in the U.S. or elsewhere are the ones having to send money to them. They're staying in hotels where maybe they have, you know, it's $50 U.S. a day. So they are now at a point of desperation, but they don't want to go back to Haiti. You know, for them, this is a country that's unstable. This is a country with the whole gang situation. This is a country that has changed in the 2 years, the 6 years, the 10 years, the 14 years that they have been away. So they take this chance based on these false rumors in an attempt to come to the United States. And so this is the difficulty that you're finding. And one of the questions that has now come up is whether or not, or how much of an effort the Department of Homeland Security is really making to deport people, not to Haiti, but back to Brazil or Chile or, you know, or even Mexico, where some of these migrants actually have legal status. You know, some of them have legal status in this country, especially Brazil. And if given a choice, they would choose to go back there rather than go to Haiti, not because they don't love their country, but because as difficult as the place was that they left, Brazil, Chile, for them, it's still a much better existence than it was in Haiti. At least they can work. They can, you know, they can help their families. But we are not getting any sort of access to DHS Mayorkas yesterday, secretary, at a press conference, and then we wouldn't get an answer. And that's been the very difficult part of being a journalist on the story, is that immigration in the U.S. is already not very transparent. It's very closed. It happens behind closed doors. But given the magnitude of this, we're not getting access to the camps. We're not getting the questions. We don't know how they're picking and choosing who goes, who stays. What we do know, though, is that thousands and thousands of people will find themselves back in Haiti in the coming days.
Well, I'd like to bring in Gerlene Joseph, co-founder and executive director of Haitian Bridge Alliance. Welcome you back to Democracy Now! Your response to what has been happening, the dramatic footage over the weekend of U.S. Border Patrol agents on horseback attempting to corral the Haitian migrants with whips back to the Mexican side of the Rio Grande. What's your sense of how this crisis has developed so quickly?
My apologies. That's the reality on the ground. Thank you so much for having me. The picture you see, the horrific reality that we are living right now. And before we even go into more the details, it's the narrative that people are using. I remember seeing one of the elected officials in the area, Ted Cruz, the first video he had saying Haitians are invading our country and they needed to be deported. So the pictures you're seeing with this officer on his horse and literally whipping, seem to be whipping the Haitian migrant, the black body, that is not a new picture in America. That is the picture of the system, of the anti-black racism that the system is based upon. As a black woman, as an American woman, as a Haitian woman, I am horrified by that picture. I'm horrified that today in 2021, we at the United States of America are behaving in such a way where we literally do not even consider the humanity of a person, so that the world is watching. And that is the picture they are seeing. The picture they are seeing is of men in horseback whipping black bodies. That is what the world is seeing in America right now. And for them to be deporting young children into Haiti right now, as Jacqueline Charles just described for you, it is unacceptable. We are in utter disbelief of what we are seeing right now. And also wanted to make clear that people understand that those 10,000 Haitians and other migrants who are under the bridge right now did not just come and storm the border. They have been here waiting for a chance to ask for asylum, which, by the way, is the legal thing for them to do. A lot of people end up entering without inspection, but it is not illegal for people to come and ask for asylum. But due to misinformation, as you heard from Jacqueline Charles, people are desperate. And if you tell them if you go here, you might have a chance to get protection. So people are leaving their respective cities, such as Tijuana and other places, coming here because they thought they might finally get protection. They might finally get to a space to call home. They might finally be able to sleep better at night. That is what we are seeing. We are not having an invasion of Haitians at the U.S.-Mexico border. We are seeing the consequence of the prior administration completely destroying the asylum system, completely destroying the immigration system with MPP, with the metering, with Title 42, that this administration continues to use as a trap to cage bodies, as we are seeing right now, black bodies, and deport them to the very danger they have fled.
And just to be clear, Title 42 is the pandemic title that Trump invoked, but President Biden is enforcing to say you can deport people during a pandemic for, quote, public health reasons. A judge just ruled that that is illegal, but the Biden administration is appealing that. Your response, Jacqueline, your response to that, Gerline.
Everything that we are seeing right now, within the community, within the movement, are completely baffled as to why the judge just told the administration it is illegal for them to continue the use of Title 42. Yet the administration, instead of doing the right thing, is actually fighting, right, against really providing protection for the people. That is why we must push back. We are tired, we are exhausted, but we are here. We are here to let the migrants, the asylum seekers, know that they are not alone. We will continue to fight for them. We will continue to advocate for them because their lives matter. Black boy, the black man that is being whipped by this officer, his life matter. So we must continue to fight. We are asking and urging the Biden administration to immediately stop all deportations to Haiti in view of what we are what's happening. The world is watching America.
I want to ask Jacqueline Charles about the latest news on the assassination of the Haitian president, Jovenel Moïse. Your recent Miami Herald article is headlined, "Grenade Dropping Drones, a Paranoid President, Guards Who Ran, Latest on Haiti Assassination." In it, you write, the night Moise was shot was actually the second time in a span of weeks his life was in danger, according to testimony from one of the Colombians in custody, one of the Haitian Americans as well. 2 weeks earlier, a plan to arrest Moise using a bogus arrest warrant upon his return from a trip to Turkey was thwarted when a signal to act was never given. That's according to Jane Roberto Carmona Flores, an ex-Colombian soldier now in custody. He told this to police. Another plan to employ disgruntled, masked Haitian police officers known as Phantom 509 to grab the president was also aborted, according to people involved. And you write, according to this report, what is Phantom 509? Who is Joseph Felix Baddio? And what role may he have played in the assassination of President Moise? Is there a warrant for his arrest?
So Phantom 509 is a disgruntled part inside the police. Some of them are active, some of them are former. A number of them have been arrested, in recently. But earlier this year, some of your viewers may recall, we saw the police in Haiti protesting, taking on the streets, blowing up cars, letting out prisoners. And what you have is inside the police is this. Low morale, people just feeling that, they're working as police officers, they cannot survive. And we've been watching this implosion of a police force in Haiti that the United States government actually, supports financially. The UN has trained, and has rebuilt, but we've seen it just crumble in front of us. And one of the things that I found in my investigation when I was, looking at these reports and talking to people is that it appears is that low morale, that disgruntledness inside the Haitian National Police found its way also into the presidential security apparatus. There, according to his wife, there should have been 30 to 50 police officers assigned to President Jovenel Moise. But on the night in question, the 7th of July, there were seven police officers that were assigned, one of whom disappeared at 4 p.m. and did not come back until after the assassination. This, according to testimony, this particular gentleman is actually a leader, a team leader. So you had six officers that were there on the ground. And what was interesting is that all of these officers who were interviewed, whether they have been taken into custody for lack of action or for alleged involvement, or they have not been arrested, but they provide additional information, they told police investigators that under no circumstances that they were allowed in President Jovenel Moise's house. So could you imagine, you are part of the protection of a president, think Secret Service in the United States, and that they are not allowed in the private residence of President Biden. This is what was happening here. So on the night in question, none of these guys and girls attempted to go inside the president's house where there was an evacuation plan. There was a back door. So for 30 to 45 minutes, President Jovenel Moise is hearing drones dropping grenades. He's hearing automatic gunfire. He's calling the phone frantically. Come save me. My life is in danger. Send reinforcements. Nobody showed up. By the time, a high-ranking officer actually came, the president was dead. His wife was seriously injured. And these, soldiers who insisted they were not there to kill the president, they had nothing to do with it. They were there to arrest him and to help to install the new president. It's the story that they're told. They're telling along with, two Haitian Americans who said they were translators. There was a sort of firefight that was going on. Baggio is a former government functionary. He's been in the Ministry of Immigration. He was a consultant until May when he was fired for quote unquote ethical breaches. He worked in the Ministry of the Anti-Corruption Government Unit. This is a guy who was well known in Haiti's political circles. In terms of people in power. President Moise knew him. I heard that he at one point, Baggio was even on a short list for a job in the government in Moise's administration. So he is described by police in this report as quote unquote one of the brains of this operation.
Jacqueline, if I could interrupt, yes. We only have about a minute left, but I just wanted to ask you, in terms of the leaked report, there have been over 40 people taken into custody, but no indication of this in this report of who actually was the mastermind of this assassination.
Exactly. Exactly. So police just tell you, you know, they're still saying that it was Sano, who's a Haitian American doctor and pastor, that he's one of the masterminds, or Badiou is one of the brains. But the report still does not tell us, you know, who finances. What we have found at the Miami Herald in our independent investigation is the people in custody did not have the means, the financial means, to finance this. And so this is the job of the investigative judge who now has the case. He has to continue the probe. And that's the question, whether or not with the assistance of the FBI, HSI from the U.S., whether or not we will be able to find out who truly financed this very expensive and expansive operation to kill a president.
But Jacqueline, now the prosecutor was going to charge the prime minister, Ariel Henry. And so he fired the prosecutor and the justice minister.
No. The prosecutor was fired when he did this. And under legal experts in Haiti, the prosecutor was out of his jurisdiction. Once a case has gone to an investigative judge, a prosecutor cannot mount a parallel investigation. And I think what we saw, this was an example in terms of how this case is starting to become politicized. You have judges who are in hiding, who have fled, clerks who have fled, who are part of the initial investigation. And this is a concern in terms of whether or not they will allow this process to work the way it's supposed to work in a country that already has issues with its judiciary. So the prosecutor, based on the letter that we got from the prime minister's office and when it was dated, he was already fired when he did this. But legal experts said even if he was not fired, he had no legal jurisdiction to try to mount a separate investigation against the prime minister based on the fact that police says there were two phone calls from Badiou more than 3 hours after the president was killed. And Badiou was in conversations with a number of other politicians. There was one call that we saw on there where he was in constant communication with somebody over 200 times. He was even in conversations with his girlfriend the night up, and his apartment is right there in the same neighborhood as the president. But we haven't heard anything about these other individuals. But what you did hear about is a fire prosecutor trying to go after the current prime minister on this.
Well, there is so much to unpack here. We can't do it now, but we thank you so much, Jacqueline Charles, Miami Herald's Haiti and Caribbean correspondent, speaking to us from Del Rio, Texas, and Gerline Joseph, executive director of the Haitian Bridge Alliance, also in Del Rio, where up to 15,000 Haitians are. Hundreds have been deported to Haiti, and it's expected more will be. Coming up, we go to Texas, or we stay there, to speak with an abortion provider about Texas' near total ban on abortions. Back in 30 seconds.
When you're tired and you want to break free, remind yourself it's not my time to leave. And when you feel there's no hope to be found, please remember all the strength it took to get you here. Get you here. I know there's days you fear all hope is gone, but I trust that you'll still...
Don't Give Up Now by Cynthia Erivo and Oliver Thompson. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez as we turn to look at Texas' near-total ban on abortions. Last week, the Department of Justice sued Texas over a new law which bars abortions around 6 weeks into a pregnancy, without an exception for rape or incest, and allows anyone in Texas to sue patients, medical workers, or even a patient's family or friends who so-called aid and abetted an abortion, like took someone to a women's health clinic. Over the weekend, a longtime physician in Texas revealed he's defied the law and provided an abortion in order to care for one of his patients. Dr. Alan Braid made the admission in an article for The Washington Post. He writes, quote, "I acted because I had a duty of care to this patient, as I do for all patients, and because she has a fundamental right to receive this care. I fully understood that there could be legal consequences, but I wanted to make sure that Texas did not get away with its bid to prevent this blatantly unconstitutional law from being tested." Dr. Braid went on to recall how he was in medical school in 1972, a year before the Supreme Court's Roe v. Wade ruling, guaranteeing the right to a safe and legal abortion. Dr. Braid wrote, "At the hospital that year, I saw three teenagers die from illegal abortions. I can't just sit back and watch us return to 1972, he said. For more on the attack on reproductive rights in Texas, we're joined by Dr. Bravik Kumar, staff physician at Planned Parenthood Center for Choice in Houston, Texas. Dr. Kumar, welcome to Democracy Now! I've been reading so much about you, dedicated provider of trans care and abortion services. One article in Outsmart magazine began, "Growing up brown, gay, and marginalized in a small Texas town inspired Houstonian Bravik Kumar to become the activist and physician he is today." How does your background relate to why you have taken such a strong stand against this almost total abortion ban in Texas?
Yeah, I think my experience of oppression growing up in Texas and feeling it on so many fronts is the same thing that's continuing to happen, whether it comes to folks trying to ban access to trans care or access to abortion. It's relentless, it's not helpful, and it's just hurting people.
And Dr. Kumar, could you talk about some of the impact of this law on your patients already?
Yeah, I think what we see time and time again is when we ban abortion, it doesn't stop the need for people to access abortion. And some of what Dr. Bray talked about seeing people in the hospital when abortion is illegal, is exactly what we're worried about. So what we're seeing on the ground right now, it's been about 3 weeks since this law has been in effect. And again, the need for abortion has not changed. It just means that now we're helping people go out of state for the care that they need. And in other neighboring states, there are a number of restrictions that are in place. There's already a limit on the number of clinics that are available, and they're already busy seeing people as well. So the need is there, but unfortunately, people are now being forced to go out of state, and some people just can't make it out of state. The logistics and the things that are required, the cost of going out of state is insurmountable for some people. And of course, it's always going to be the folks that are most low income, people of color, young folks, and people that are already dealing with layers of oppression.
So and you traveled in early September to Washington, to the White House to meet with Vice President Kamala Harris on a roundtable of abortion providers. What's your sense of how the administration is dealing with these efforts at the local state level to turn back Roe v. Wade?
Yeah, what we've seen over the last few decades is that abortion has really become a state-by-state issue. And depending on which state you live determines what kind of access you have to abortion, which is really unfair for each person that's living in a state that has restrictive access, or in a state like Texas, where abortion is essentially inaccessible. So I was pleased to hear from the Biden-Harris administration that they have our backs, that they are supportive of the work that we do. And what we really need is the federal government to step in and codify Roe, to pass the Women's Health Protection Act, and make sure that our rights are protected under federal law, and that way we don't have a state-by-state access-in-access sort of mosaic that's taken place.
Dr. Kumar, do you have numbers? You talked about, you know, clinics shutting down in Texas. And this key point that you raise, you have to go out of state. Impossible for so many women, particularly low-income women. This particularly hurts the Black and brown communities. So essentially, has abortion ended in Texas, the home state of Roe v. Wade?
It essentially has, yeah. There are very few patients that we can take care of. What we know is roughly 10% of folks may qualify for an abortion in Texas based on not having cardiac motion. And this is the first time that a law like this has been passed. And so, again, it's only been a couple of weeks, but we're seeing roughly about that. Maybe 10% of people that we typically see are still able to get an abortion in Texas. But the rest of the folks, the vast majority, we're trying to help them navigate care out of state. And some people are able to make it, and some people we know, and they leave our clinic saying, I'm not going to be able to do that. I'm not going to be able to take the time off. I have no one to watch my kids. Or for whatever reason, going out of state is just not an option. It's not possible for them to do that.
So final words from the state of Texas. There was a cartoon going around that said, why didn't anyone predict the Taliban takeover of Texas sooner? A play on the Taliban takeover of Afghanistan sooner. But where you see this going with the Department of Justice lawsuit, how you see this ban being lifted, or do you?
Well, I mean, I think in response to what some folks are saying, you know, I've seen the hashtag Texas Taliban. This is nothing to do with the Taliban, right? This is white conservative is Christian essentialism that's taken over. And it's not what the people want in Texas. The vast majority are supportive of abortion, but unfortunately, the people in power are pushing their agenda forward. So I think what we know from centuries of humanity is that people will always need access to abortion. I'm hopeful that one of these lawsuits will prevail and people will have access again, but it's going to take some time. And it's unfortunate that people's fundamental rights are being debated in a court and debated in public while people are suffering.
We want to thank you so much, Dr. Vivek Kumar, staff physician at Planned Parenthood Center for Choice in Houston, Texas. When we come back in 30 seconds, we look at the deadly consequences of vaccine inequality. Will India follow up on rights groups who say that the Johnson & Johnson vaccines that are being made for the world in India should not go to the United States and other European countries? Stay with us. Other by Nubia Garcia. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez as we end today's show looking at the pandemic and vaccine inequality. In India, a coalition of groups are calling on Johnson & Johnson to stop exporting Indian-made vaccines to wealthy nations like the United States at a time when hundreds of millions of people remain unvaccinated in India as well as in Africa. The groups are also urging President Biden to force Johnson & Johnson to license its vaccine to drug manufacturers in India and other nations to help produce more vaccines. We go now to Bangalore, India, where we're joined by Achal Prabala. He is a coordinator of Access IBSA Project, which campaigns for access to medicines in India, Brazil, and South Africa. Welcome back to Democracy Now!, Achal. If you can start off by laying out your demand.
Thank you, Amy. It's lovely to be here. A group of us from civil society, over a dozen organizations in India, drafted a letter very recently to Johnson & Johnson and the Biden administration with a very simple demand, which is that the 600 million doses that Johnson & Johnson is manufacturing currently at a company called Biological E in India should go where the vaccines are most needed, which is the Indian subcontinent, the African continent, and the COVAX facility, rather than where Johnson & Johnson most wants to send them to, which on the basis of recent history and the company's experience in South Africa is Europe and the United States, where it has large unfulfilled orders, which are quite lucrative, which it seems in an unseemly manner eager to supply.
And Achal, as it stands now, J&J has only one partnership with an Indian company, but while Pfizer and Moderna have none in India, South America, or Africa. Explain why the pharmaceutical companies are reluctant to establish such partnerships.
There is a curious difference in the way that Johnson & Johnson is licensing its vaccine around the world. What they're doing is to provide what's called contract manufacturing. They are farming out the production of their vaccine to other companies, but they retain control of where those vaccine doses go. So this is a little unlike AstraZeneca's contracts with the Serum Institute in India, which was supposed to be the engine for the COVAX facility, the global philanthropy that was going to distribute vaccines to the poorest countries in the world. The Johnson & Johnson contracts with Biologically in India and Aspen PharmaCare in South Africa are really under the control of Johnson & Johnson. They decide who they should go to, And these vaccine contracts were signed in 2020 when the pandemic was in a different state, when these vaccines were merely hypothetical. The problem with the way Johnson & Johnson is now enforcing these contracts is in September 2021, which is a very different world where a majority of the adults in the United States and Europe have been vaccinated, where by no means a majority or anything close to that have been vaccinated in the African continent or India. Johnson & Johnson believes it still has the right to send vaccines where it wants to rather than where it has to and where the vaccines are most needed. Now, of course, Pfizer and Moderna don't have production facilities here, but the fact is that they are outsourcing their vaccine production to facilities in Europe and in other parts of North America. But the truth is that Johnson & Johnson, Pfizer, and Moderna are off a piece. What they're doing is to say, we're not going to provide access contracts. We're not going to provide licensed manufacture of our vaccine to anyone in order for them to be able to supply the regions that they're in. We're just going to make the largest number of vaccines that we can under our control and then send them where we want. Now, the irony of this is that unlike Pfizer and Moderna, whose vaccines remain robustly desirable in the United States and Europe, the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, in fact, is not. There's poll after poll that shows that it's the least desirable vaccine among ordinary Americans, for instance. And it's not like there is surging demand for the vaccine in Europe either. So it's a bit of a conundrum because with the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, no one seems to want it in the United States. No, it doesn't seem to be able to make its own vaccine. It supplied less than 10% of what it was supposed to the U.S. It supplied under 25% of what it was supposed to Europe. And yet at the same time, there are studies from South Africa now that show that the vaccine adequately does its job in protecting people against hospitalization and death and even transmission. So there are lots of people in a majority of the world who would love to have the J&J vaccine, except they can't. And so I think it's a particularly absurd situation that Johnson & Johnson would choose to make vaccines in a part of the world that desperately needs them, and then send them to another part of the world that not only doesn't need them, but doesn't seem to want them.
Achal, just put this in human terms. Who gets the vaccine? Who has access to it? The percentages that we're talking about in Africa, in Asia, compared to the United States and Britain, where they've already started the booster on a mass scale, the third shot.
There's something astonishing about September 2021, because now we'll be nearing 10 months into a world in which vaccines exist and were available. And yet the death toll remains 10,000 people a day, and that's largely because less than 3% of the population of the African continent has been vaccinated, less than 15% of the Indian population has been vaccinated, while between 50 to 70% of the adults in the United States and Europe have been vaccinated. So what we're looking at is a world in which the pandemic is under control with occasional flare-ups and alarms and problems around mass vaccination, but nevertheless, relatively under control in the US and Europe, and absolutely not under any kind of control in a majority of the world, where the majority of the world's population lives. In such a situation, what Johnson & Johnson did in South Africa, which it had to backtrack on, which was to send 300 million doses, which could have vaccinated 300 million people, because the Johnson & Johnson vaccine is single dose, to send those vaccines to Europe in majority was a mistake. They were called out, people were outraged, and they backtracked. But now they're set to repeat exactly the same action with vaccines for 600 million people in India. And the absurdity of this situation and the inability of Johnson & Johnson to see how absurd it is, I think, is astonishing. But what's worse is actually that we have now, thanks to the Russians and thanks to the Sputnik V vaccine, which showed good efficacy.
We have 10 seconds.
Unfortunately, has run into production problems. We have 34 manufacturers around the world who can produce the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. And so what they should do is to expand their manufacturing to include these manufacturers. Then we could actually make that vaccine work in the world. It would be good for them. It would be good for us.
Achal Prabhula, we want to thank you so much for joining us from Bangalore, India. I'm Amy Goodman with Juan Gonzalez. Stay safe. Wear a mask.